Good morning. Welcome to the 12th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn and Faisal Chowdhury. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. The next item is an evidence session on the performance and operation of Social Security Scotland. Members visited the Social Security Scotland headquarters in Dundee on the 1st of November, and I'm pleased to welcome you all for the first time to the committee this morning. We had a wonderful visit last month and very much appreciated that opportunity. This morning we are joined by David Wallace, the Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland, James Wallace, who is the Deputy Director for Finance and Corporate Services, Miriam Craven, the Deputy Director for Strategy, Change, Data and Engagement. I'll invite David Wallace, please, to make any opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thank you very much for the invitation to come and speak today. I really do appreciate it, and it is lovely to be here in person as well. Just to add my thanks for those members who were able to take the time and come and visit us in Agnes Husband House in Dundee. It was lovely to see you there, and I thought it was a really helpful visit from our perspective, so hopefully you got something from it too. I really welcome the opportunity this morning to take questions on our recent publications, principally the annual report and accounts and the supporting charter measurement framework and the client survey as well. I should briefly introduce my colleagues. So on my right is James Wallace and on my left is Miriam Craven. James and Miriam will assist us with the session this morning. So this is our third annual report and accounts since the agency was launched back in 2018. And it covers the period of April 2020 up to March 2021, a year where, like everybody else, clearly COVID had really been with us for the duration of that year. So I just wanted to draw out some of the sort of key highlights that I saw in the annual report and accounts. And principally, I should put on record that I'm incredibly proud that the agency managed to maintain our services to clients throughout that period of time as well, working through the pandemic. That involves successfully moving the vast majority of our staff to work from home, and indeed the vast majority remain there just now as well, so that was no mean feat. It also required some very rapid systems development, so to allow that to happen we had to move very quickly on our call answering system, and in particular introduced a brand new web chat which has remained popular as well. So really pleased at that. But we didn't just stand still from that. We also welcomed over 400 new colleagues into the organisation during that time. And we had to do that using both virtual recruitment and virtual induction as well. So that was a big shift in terms of our approach. And doing that allowed us to introduce a further three benefits in Scotland, two of which were brand new to people in Scotland, being the JobStart payment, and also what has been described as the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which is, from Social Security Scotland's perspective, by far the largest benefit so far. All of that has allowed us to make over 900,000 payments to people across 10 benefits, and that totals now over £100 million of money which would not otherwise have been received by people in Scotland, which we've been able to make. You'll notice in this year's annual set of annual report and accounts, a significant difference now is the inclusion of all the devolved benefits, including those that are processed for us by DWP. So this is the first set of accounts that covers both those directly delivered and those agency agreement ones as well. As you know, how we deliver benefits is as important as to what we deliver as well. So I was really pleased the annual report captures some feedback from the charter measurement research, and you'll see that in the annual report and accounts as well. This is, again, the first time we've been able to carry out such a full survey of the charter measurement. Previously, we'd had either limited in terms of year or we would have it slightly skewed towards one benefit. So I think this is a really important milestone and really important insight from our clients. Briefly, I just want to pull out a couple of figures from that. So I was really delighted that 92% of those who took part in the client survey said their experience was either good or very good, and clients who spoke to our staff found our staff both knowledgeable and approachable. And the particular one which I always focus on in the charter measurement was that 94% of respondents agreed that when they spoke to the organisation, they'd been treated with kindness, which I think is a really key measure for me in terms of a different service in Scotland. So just finally reflecting, I'm really proud of what Social Security Scotland achieved through what has undoubtedly been a challenging year. We are not complacent in any way. We absolutely know that Social Security Scotland is a work in progress, and it will be a number of years before we reach something that looks like a steady state organisation. But I think we have laid some good foundations of building a new public service. And we've done that, which I should draw out, where the majority of our staff now have not set foot in a building, and the majority of our staff, we have been working for longer since we were established with restrictions and without, so it is unusual circumstances. We don't do this alone. We do this with very close joint working with the Scottish Government's Social Security Directorate and Programme. And again, we have a number of joint activities and preparedness for the future benefits to come as well. Since, obviously, we've published the annual report and accounts as well, the child disability payment prior to pilot has now gone nationally live as well. So particularly pleased to see that. But I'm happy to take any questions now.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Wallace. That's greatly appreciated. I'll now turn to questions from colleagues. I'll allow up until around 10:30 for this section before we move on to the next item of business that we have. And the first question is from Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. It's great to see you again, and thanks for taking the time to meet with us in Dundee. I really found it very helpful. Got a few questions. We want a human rights-based approach that includes the importance of access to redeterminations and appeals, and the number of appeals seem very low, and the staff knowledge around it seems poor. I think there was 40 quoted in the report. How do we promote the right to appeal to staff and claimants?
So it is a very small number, and I think that's... Sorry.
I thought you did.
No, it's okay. It's okay. So I think the thing that you pointed out there is a small number, so I would be hesitant about drawing conclusions from the small numbers. I would also look across the whole of the redetermination and appeals processes as well. So, as you know, one of the key features that we were trying to do differently in Social Security Scotland was to make that whole process both easier and accessible. So the way that redeterminations are dealt with within the organisation, and I might bring Miriam in to say a little bit more around about that, I think leads to some of those lower levels of appeals in the system. So for example, if somebody asks for a redetermination, as you'll know through the passage of the bill, that's something that's stood back from and looked entirely separately. The approach has been that the team dealing with that would be in contact with the client as well. So we will find that a large number of cases are dealt with through that redetermination period before they get to the appeals period as well. I don't know, Miriam, if you want to add something to that.
I think, yes, just to add to that, in terms of raising awareness about how to make a redetermination, when we tell clients their original decision, we also include information in that about how to lodge for a redetermination. And they can do that over the phone or they can do that on paper as well. So it's about that encouraging of letting people know how to do it. And as David has said as well, we make sure that the journey that somebody goes on, they're having an engagement with the team who look after them. You also mentioned about the staff and making sure that the staff are aware. And as we've grown as an organisation over the last year, it is important to make sure it's a key part of the training and also how to have a smooth transition. So if you phone up and want to be put through to the team who deal with the redeterminations, but also it's about working with our stakeholders as we roll out each new benefit. It's an important part to make sure that when we're raising that awareness and doing the engagement with the people who are supporting people and giving that advice and guidance around it to make sure they understand the redetermination process as well. And I think the last thing I would just add is agree with David that for us it's important that the ambition around if we need to change a decision at redeterminations, that is an encouraged approach we have because normally you get a new piece of evidence in at that stage and we would overturn our decision. And that's why you see less moving to that appeal stage because it's acting on the case at that stage in the redetermination process.
Thank you. The staff survey, though, responses indicated that some staff found the internal redetermination process quite complicated. How is the organisation responding to that feedback from the survey?
So I'll come in on that. So I think just before I answer that, just to briefly add to Miriam's point as well, I think it's also important just to recognise the new advocacy contract that's come in place since the set of publications we're looking at as well, and we will be doing more work to make sure that's highlighted. Obviously, there's a balance for us to ensure that that advocacy contract is seen as fully independent from the organisation, so our role is to make sure that people are made aware of it rather than to necessarily be seen as an additional part of the agency. But I think, like everything else in terms of awareness, we have a very new organisation. So as I said in the opening remarks there, the vast majority of people now have joined very recently. The vast majority have joined in a way that they have not been into our buildings, they've not gone through the sort of process we would have liked around about consolidation. So it's one of the areas that we're looking at as to how we bring people into the organisation now. We think virtual recruitment works pretty well, we think virtual induction works pretty well, but there is just something about getting people up to that, actually knowing the job, which really it's difficult to find a substitute from just being in and around a team and learning from that team. So there are things that we do where people will have a buddy when they join the organisation, but again, even just the sort of slight behaviour of being reticent to have that approach to a buddy in a virtual world versus if you could just put your hand up and shout across the table of how do I do that. And when I learnt how to do casework and many years ago, that was the real thing. You learnt from the team around about you. You heard a difficult call going in. You learnt just how a more experienced colleague dealt with a caller on the phone. And that's the thing that I think we've really struggled to recreate. So again, we're hopeful now and we're bringing people back for some of that consolidation training to try and replicate that as well.
Thank you. What are we doing to improve the call waiting and the processing times?
So I think if you're looking at the numbers from the annual report and accounts, obviously that does also cover a period which, as I said in the opening remarks, was covered by COVID. So at the early stage of COVID, we did make the decision to send people to work from home. And the one bit of technology that was not portable then was the telephony system. So for a period of time, we were unable to handle incoming calls. We went through a series of developments. So we went through from a very basic, we gave people mobile phones and people could log a call and we could phone back out. And then eventually we got some more tactical solutions in place to put that online. So I think the annual report and account covers a period that was difficult because we simply did not have the technology in place to answer inbound calls. As you'll know, what we now publish for all the individual benefits is a full set of performance information in terms of processing and telephony times as well. So I think you will see from some of the data coming out for this financial year that we have continued to improve that. So the call waiting times will go up and down depending on benefit launches and other activities. But fundamentally, I would say the period that we're looking at does cover a point that was particularly tricky.
Thank you. Thanks, Camilla. I'll leave it there for theme one, but I'll come back in later. Thanks.
Thank you. Next set of questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. It's nice to see you again. And it's good to do it in person, I would agree. So I fully acknowledge that the results of the client survey were relatively, in fact, pretty overwhelmingly positive. I'm just really, really keen that where there were some improvements suggested that could be made, that we nip that in the bud quite quickly. So I have a couple of questions around that. In particular, one in four people felt that they weren't able to challenge the decision that was taken by Social Security Scotland. So I'm wondering what you're going to do about that, given what we know about the inability for people to challenge decisions in other areas of Social Security, and in particular in the DWP. I'm also keen to know that about all of the redeterminations that were made, half of them were successful. So that's quite a lot, and I know that there weren't many made, but of the ones that were, because half of them were successful, I'm keen to know what you're going to do to address the original problems that caused the problem in the decision making. And then I have another couple of questions on this theme, but I'll come back to them if that's okay. Thanks.
Okay, I'll take the first one first, and again I might pull Miriam into both of those questions as well. I think on the client survey and charter measurement information, It is obviously quite a recent document for us as well as for the committee. So we published that in November, which is the same time that the organisation was getting that information as well. So Miriam can say a little bit more about the structure within the organisation as to how we take some of that information back and put improvements in it as well. But I would see it also as part of a far wider, just a culture of continuous improvement we're trying to embed in the organisation. So you'll see some things in the annual report and account around about very, very practical examples of when feedback's been given and we've been able to take some direct action as a result of it. I accept it's not on the point that you've raised there. But we're keen that we can demonstrate that, you know, the client tells us something and our stakeholders tell us something and we can take some direct action. So the annual report and accounts has some very practical examples of that. Back to the other point, but maybe just let Miriam just say about how the teams in the agency are dealing with that.
Yes, so the team who've produced the report around the Charter Measurement Framework work very closely across the organisation to bring the findings to the people who can implement the changes and respond to it. So that is about working across the board with our colleagues who work in that frontline client delivery side and looking at actually what has been said from a client and a staff viewpoint, and also through our change process about how we prioritise what changes we need to see, whether that be in the system or the wording of a letter. So it forms, as David says, part of that continuous improvement. But also within our governance structure that we have an insights team who would be looking at actually what are the themes coming out, what are the findings, and then how do we marry that up to see the improvements. And as David said, it's one part because we also look at what we hear within internal audit, and also we have a feedback structure where both clients and staff can give us that. And the question, I don't know if you want to answer first around why we overturn some of those decisions. Would you want to cover it?
Okay.
So in terms of, as you say, the numbers are quite small, but the overturning for me, looking more at that in a little bit more detail, I think it's really good that we overturn those decisions, because when you're looking at the benefits that are covered within this reporting time, it is one-off payments or, you know, the low-income benefit space, and they normally, most of those rely on making sure that somebody is in receipt of a benefit at a UK level. So what is happening is when the first decision has been made, people have not actually received their UK benefit yet, so we then have to wait. So when they come into the redetermination process, we may get new evidence that says they're now in receipt, so we overturn rather than putting the person through to go to appeal stage. So it's new evidence normally coming in, or, you know, it can be that there was something that actually was an oversight and we hadn't seen that that documentation was supplied, so we encourage that overturning at that stage to bring that improvement in.
Just to briefly back up, I mean, Miriam stole a little bit of what I would have said there. But I think there is a really important cultural point about the organisation not being afraid to overturn a decision. So I we've deliberately not set what is a target level. As I said in the opening statement, we're still, you know, just 3 years into doing this, understanding what a cycle looks like, understanding what a good or bad level of that overturning. So as an organisation, we certainly don't want to sort of imply that a certain level is the right level. We want these to be proper decisions made, you know, differently from the first decision. And if the evidence is now there to do that, we would do it. But I don't want to create an organisation that fears overturning a previously made decision. So it is, again, small numbers, a small cycle in terms of payments. And I think we're still developing actually what potentially good or bad looks like in terms of an overturning level.
Thank you for that. Can I ask just another supplementary? Thank you, Convener. And that's reassuring. I'm really pleased that there isn't that kind of arbitrary, I guess, in some ways, sort of cut off in terms of overturning. So thank you for that. In terms of the workforce and their ability to refer on to other agencies, I think that if we are to get to a system that's much more automated, less reliant on individuals having to talk too many people at once, we probably need to make sure that those referral processes are tight. I also note that you now are part of the Tell Me Once programme. So what are your plans to address the staff capacity to refer on to other agencies? What can you learn, or what do you know about the Tell Me Once process? And I know that that's when someone dies, but is there anything that you can replicate from that type of process that could be used at the other end of the scale when people begin to apply for their benefits, and that you could only therefore tell the state, as it were, if you were the state party, the state organisation, once?
So I'll maybe do that in slightly reverse order. I mean, I think the tell me once is a, you know, a well trodden, a well understood, and a good thing in terms of removing stress and elements on clients in difficult circumstances. Again, slightly referring back to the session we had in Dundee, we know there's a degree of automation which both our stakeholders and clients would like to see in a system, which just where we are in terms of development, we don't yet have. So I think there is a lot of demand around about making the once easier. Some of that we'll be able to do as we launch benefits. Some of that might be slightly further down the track in terms of further things. For the benefits that we do, we try to ensure that we're not asking clients for multiple information for multiple benefits. So I think you see that through the sort of series of Best Start grant, for example, and how that integrates with the same application for Scottish Child Payments, so that, you know, we aren't asking people an application per benefit as such. So we're trying to build that into our own benefits, but it will take a little bit longer when it's more mature before we can do some of the automation that's probably being looked for. And sorry, the first part of that question was around about staff awareness of that.
Referrals.
So I think this again is a bit of a process that's ongoing. So particularly given, you know, 2 weeks ago Monday we launched our local delivery service, is where if people are wanting to come for that pre-application support, particularly on disability benefits, obviously launched to coincide with the national launch of child disability payment. That's where a lot of that intelligence will be. That's where a lot of that referral will be. And as well as the sort of the national obvious points of referral, as it were, they've also done an awful lot of work on the ground with more local stakeholders, so that they are embedded in some of these organisations. They'll go to where these organisations are, so that there's both national and local referrals available. But that is clearly quite embryonic in terms of how that's operating and has only been in place for a couple of weeks. I don't know, Miriam, if there's anything you want to add to that.
Yeah, I would just add, in terms of the referral process, we understand the importance of having that, and it's making sure that there's that no wrong door policy, that when you come looking for the information to give you that support. We also have to build a good, strong, robust structure around that to make sure that this is people's data that we are sharing. So we need to be really mindful of the fact that how you get that permission to be allowed to say that we want to refer you to another organisation and what that looks like. So we're making sure that we take the time to build a good, robust structure. We've seen some good evidence around the country of referrals that work really well, but it's making sure that we build something that we can use at a national level and a local level as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Before I bring in Jeremy Balfour for the next set of questions, I'd like to pick up on a couple of things that you've mentioned, both in your opening statement and in response to questions already, Mr. Wallace. First of all, it's around COVID and lessons from COVID. And can I just say on behalf of the committee, thank you to your staff for all that you have been doing during the pandemic. And like all public, private, third sector organisations, the adaptations that have had to be made have obviously been significant. So I wonder what lessons you have learned in terms of your experiences during COVID, both in terms of your relationship with the people who rely on your services, but also in terms of your own organisational structure and how, whether there's been any changes that you'd be looking to make to your organisation as a result of your experiences during the pandemic?
Gosh, I'll maybe do the organisational back to front if that's okay. So again, I think like all organisations, still grappling with some of the implications of what COVID has looked like. The positive aspects, I think we know we can run services in a different way, building in flexibility that our staff would be looking for in terms of a more hybrid scale of work. So we have an active project underway inside the organisation which is exploring what that hybrid might look like. But I think as an organisation, we will not return to what I think we had previously, where everybody was in at a desk, you know, 5 days a week. That, in common with lots of organisations, isn't what we will go back to. And James might want to say more about an active project we've got looking at that. So that's live at the moment, and that's common across lots of organisations. I think just in response, you know, as I was saying earlier on, I think they're also clearer now of some of the things we cannot do. So the areas where we would want to get teams together to do more of the transformational work, more of the forward thinking work, and more of the staff development. Again, just that point about how you bring people on as well. And I know the sort of emerging work about what this means to the workforce, and particularly the younger workforce, how you bring them through and give them role models as well. So I think from an organisational point of view, the big thing for us is we know we can run the services slightly differently, and that's where we'll try and pursue it. The impact in terms of how we work with our clients, I think, again, is probably emerging as we do more of the local delivery, for example. So some of that has been through the use of video, for example, and I think that's been well received. So the original model that local delivery would be face-to-face, that there will be a place for that, and we will absolutely ensure that where face-to-face is needed, we'll make sure that happens. But I think there's something about the behaviour of clients and, you know, society as a large now that is probably more used to interacting in a digital way. So we'll want to try and make sure we get some of the advantages of that. But I should absolutely just be clear, that does not mean we're backing away from channel choice. And in that sense, you know, people will have how they want to interact with the organisation is a really important one. So I think that's just emerging. And again, in common with everyone else, just understanding what you know, the period of working from home in particular has done both to the culture of the organisation, but also people's health and well-being as well of our own internal staff. So they're just trying to get that into balance.
Thank you, that's helpful. In terms of data, I think we'll come back in future sessions around the data that you capture in terms of some of the bigger benefits that are coming on stream, particularly around adult and child disability. But I'm keen to explore with you the challenges that you've had with regards to data that you would need access to from other organisations, particularly the DWP. And that has obviously been a challenge in terms of the rollout of the Scottish Child Payment that had to be delayed because of delays to data coming on board for you, being able to access eligibility, because obviously that is dependent on universal credit. So how challenging has that been for you, and what are you doing to try to overcome those issues in terms of ensuring that you're getting access to the data that you need?
So I'll probably go back to my opening statement when I was, you know, the way we work with the Scottish Government and the Social Security Programme is really important in here as well. So the Social Security Scotland is responsible for the live benefits. And clearly we won't go into a live benefit world if there's dubiety over whether or not we can get the data we need to support applications. So I think a lot of the how we get data from DWP in particular is established during that programme element as we're looking at the service and, you know, how we support and build a system before it goes live. So it's probably a question that's best asked either of ministers or Scottish Government in terms of that. By the time it comes to us, you know, there is no doubt as to whether or not we can access the data we need. You know, we can't go into a live benefit situation where we're unsure about whether we've got the data. So I think I would sort of draw the line between the activity that's needed before we get that assurance and then as we go live. But as accountable officer for the organisation, I wouldn't be going into a live benefit world if we were still having to negotiate over whether or not we could get the data that we needed. We may come on to it in terms of sort of agile development in a different area, but how we access that data, you know, is maybe a factor of it, but getting the data has to be established before we go live.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, and good morning. And again, thank you. It's good to see you all here. I wonder if I could move on to the issue of overpayments. And you know, I think we all know that happens irregularly, particularly fraud happens, you know, not very often, but it does happen. And when I was a member of the tribunals, we had to hear some of those cases. I'm just wondering, obviously with the adult benefits being transferred next year, that will become probably more of a live issue than other benefits at the moment. What methodology are you going to use? Clearly, we want to keep the founding principles of dignity, respect, etc., etc. But at the same time, you know, there are people out there who do claim fraudulently. How will that be investigated, and what way will you use to deal with that?
So I'll certainly bring James in to say a little bit more about that, but just in general, I think we would draw some distinction between fraud and overpayments, obviously. And again, that was, you know, a source of debate as some of the legislation passed through as well. So we have an absolute zero tolerance policy to fraud. We're building up our counter-fraud capability and our investigation powers so that we can tackle fraud where we see fraud in the system. So James can say more, but we have a growing expertise around about how we tackle fraud, and you know, there is a zero tolerance policy to that. I think the distinction between how overpayments occur versus fraud, so obviously not all overpayments are of course a fraud, and that was one of the key things I think that clients and stakeholders would tell us about the system, of destigmatising some of this. It is a complex system, and you know, we are now having a system across two, you know, ourselves and DWP, so there will be overpayment in that system, and I think it's important not to refer to all of that as being fraudulent. That's something slightly different. So in overpayments itself, obviously we cannot recover overpayments where that's been made as a result of error. And again, you'll have seen this through your own experience of people who, from no fault of their own, had been effectively hit with a large overpayment, and you know, the recovery of that had significant impacts of it. So again, there's a bit of a line around about overpayments where it's realistically expectation that the client has told us something. And at that point, you know, there's a kind of line between that and how we recover it. We're looking in terms of recovery, so we'll have regard to the common financial arrangement, so that we're not leaving people in circumstances which are inappropriate. But James, I don't know if you want to say a little bit more around about the recovery of overpayments itself.
I can. So I think it's a very good question. It's how do you build dignity, fairness and respect into the recovery of overpayments? And I think it was considered when the Social Security Act was going through Parliament, at Section 65 of the Act, which places an obligation on the agency to take account of the individual's financial circumstances. So David is absolutely correct. We would only recover an overpayment through fraud or error where it's the client's fault, where it's our fault, where it's an official error. We do not recover. The client has no liability unless it is large or obvious, which means fairly rarely. It's the difference between if a client is expecting £100 and we send them £100,000, it would never happen. But if that was the case, it would be large and obvious. Whereas if we accidentally paid the client £101 as opposed to £100, we would say, well, the client is clearly not going to realise that it's a pound, so we would not seek to recover that. So official error only in specified circumstances. Client error is different, and I think that's where Section 65 of the Act comes in. So we do use the common financial tool, or we will use the common financial tool to assess the client's circumstances to make sure that we're taking account of the client's ability to pay. We would not want to push anyone into hardship, and I think that's the bit that's different for me. That's the bit that makes us slightly different from other public sector organisations. I don't think it will affect recovery, and I need to go on and say a little bit about that. That through the period of COVID, we have paused recovery. So I think recognising people's financial circumstances, we put a pause on recovery. I think it's fair to say, and you will see from our annual report and accounts, that the levels of debt are fairly small at the moment. So there was no significant issue really with us pausing the recovery, and it felt like the right thing to do. That is getting ready to restart, which is useful for the team. And I can move on to your next point about counter fraud. So in the intervening COVID period, I've been building my fraud, error, debt teams, and those are all well staffed now and trained. I think Audit Scotland have recognised the good progress we've made towards our arrangements for counter fraud. They're all highly trained counter fraud specialists. We've invested heavily in that area, and we are prepared for the bigger benefits, the child disability payment that's just gone live, and the adult disability payment when it goes live. So we have those robust arrangements in place now to be able to respond to fraud, error, and make use of the principles in the Act to guide the way in which we recover.
Just briefly, I'm conscious of time. I had a case once where someone was due £1,000 and got £110,000 and never declared it, but we'll move on from that. But I think one of the things that has been difficult under the present system for DWP is every year you get your annual letter and it says in a kind of paragraph 4, if your circumstances have changed, you need to let us know. And I suspect most people, including myself, never read that line. And people's circumstances do change. Either we need more benefit or we need less benefit. And I'm not convinced one line in an annual letter. How do you see the new agency communicating maybe more effectively with people who are being going to be transferred on from PIP? If it goes worse or better, how will that be communicated to them in maybe a more enlightening way?
Very good. But I should just absolutely put on record, we do have things in place to stop the multiples, hundreds of thousands going out the door. I think it's a really good point. And when we speak to DWP, it's the point that they would say is the really difficult thing of change of circumstances. So again, where the vast majority of that overpayment comes in isn't somebody being unclear about their circumstances at the point of application. It is that point of change. It's one of those things I think I would have to sort of look at the service design. And again, adult disability is still in that service design place as to how we do it. I think you're right to identify as the agency goes more into those recurring payments. So until quite recently, the agency has generally had one-off payments. You make an application, we take a view at it, the circumstances are right, yes, we make a payment. As we go into that recurring element of payments, it's where that can become a far bigger issue. And you're right, if that goes on then for a number of years, that can accumulate quite rapidly. Under what we're describing, if it's reasonable that somebody should have told us that change, then we would consider that, I think, to be recoverable over payment. So how we communicate that out, I think, will be really important. We will certainly take the service design point away, because you're right, having it in a letter is fine, but it can't be the only thing. I think there is probably some work for us to do with both stakeholder organisations, possibly how technology operates in that as well. But at the moment, I don't remember if you're any closer to how we currently say that.
Yes, I think what's important is the user-centred design. So as you rightly say, Jeremy, the chance of everybody reading every line in detail is a challenge. So it's working with our client base to understand the wording of our letters and how they are landing, the length of them, the technical language in them, making sure it's plain English. We work in around inclusive communication to make sure that we can have things in different languages. We can also make sure that we meet the principles around what is good inclusive communication. Part of the design of the application form itself has been about that in conjunction with the users to make sure that the clients who will use the application understand how that works. So that includes things like images or how we describe things. And the final part I would say in it is it's the feedback coming back into the organisation. So it's being able to quickly adapt to that feedback that we get to change it. And in the change of circumstances in particular, going back to what David said at the beginning about a measure such as kindness, we want to be an organisation that you feel you can come and talk to say, actually, my circumstances have changed in one way or another. So it's that part of how we're embedded across our client base to make sure that they know that we're available to do that. But key is that wording, making sure it's plain English, it's inclusive, and that it is understood by people.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. That's very helpful. Marie McNair, followed by Miles Briggs, please.
Thanks, Convener. On the issue of overpayments from fraud and error, are there any figures available and how they kind of break up between fraud and error?
We've got some early figures, certainly on error, and again, James might want to say a little bit around about that. Fraud, again, to draw those distinctions, the legislation we have essentially only denotes something as fraud after we've been through the investigation and are clear that something is indeed fraudulent. So again, just where we are in the process of development, I think I'm right in saying the annual report and accounts report zero for fraud in that sense, because we haven't been through that process necessarily yet. And I think that is an important element of, you know, not trying to get those two things confused. I mean, the question from Mr. Balfour, I mean, is a really good one. That is where most of the overpayments occur. And I think, you know, how that makes sure that we don't automatically assume that that is fraudulent is really important. So fraud, I think I'm right in saying, James, is probably reporting in terms of zero, in terms of benefit expenditure, just because we haven't gone through that process yet. We are reporting a certainly error in terms of the DWP expenditure, and I think we're just working through the methodology at the moment as to how we'll report and estimate that for our own benefit expenditure. I don't know, James, if there's anything you want to add.
I think the bulk of the fraud and error, as the bulk of the benefits are administered under agency agreements, the DWP produce fairly extensive fraud and error statistics for us. They are well tried and tested at it. They've been doing it for many years. In terms of our annual report and accounts, we do report error on our benefits. David is absolutely correct that it is the agency does not make decisions on fraud. We would report suspected fraud to the Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service, and the courts will make a decision on what is fraud. So it doesn't actually become fraud for us until a successful prosecution is secured, if that is indeed the case. But there is data in our annual report and accounts on page 57.
Have a look. How does the overpayment recovery practice in Social Security Scotland, how does that differ from the DWP?
Well, that's a good question. I'm not wholly familiar with how DWP would operate that. And again, I think our experience of it has been both limited and interrupted by COVID. As James had said earlier, we deliberately made the decision to suspend that recovery during what was a difficult financial period, and we're only just starting to think about restarting that and making sure that we've got our strategy in place at the moment. I mean, I think probably one of the big differences from what I'm aware of, but I'll ask James just to double check this, is clearly we're not at the moment got a group of benefits that we would offset necessarily. So in DWP's benefits, if somebody's on UC and something, there can be a sort of a more automatic offsetting of an overpayment against a current payment. And again, I think you will all see your constituents then, you know, have some odd letters around about what they're actually getting paid from it. I don't know, James, is there anything else you want to say on that?
There's a couple of key differences. So we do not recover official error, the DWP do. DWP will... Well, our statutory protection for hardship is in the Act. I don't believe the DWP have an equivalent. I think the tools available to the DWP are varied. They will have administrative penalties. They can make direct attachment of earnings. I'm conscious I'm speaking for them. I think normally from time to time, or they would offset overpayments against benefits and receipt without giving the client the option, whereas the statutory protections and hardship give our clients there's a discussion before that would happen. It's not I'm being careful of my wording. Our system is set up to foster a partnership and a collegiate approach to debt recovery.
But I think, you know, from our perspective, we're happy to talk about our system, but we're not necessarily doing. Yeah, it's not the comparison that we'd necessarily make.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just on that point, do you know what levels then DWP have been asked to look towards debt recovery on behalf of Social Security Scotland? I had a look at your accounts, and from what I could see, it's estimated around £17,400 was detected with regards to internal fraud. But like you've already said, no overpayments have ever been classified. So I just wondered, in terms of that work DWP are doing, what does that look like for Social Security Scotland? Because it's transferring that really to another organisation.
Sorry, just to clarify. So is this the benefits that are currently paid under the agency agreements?
Yeah.
Then? So my understanding of that is that DWP would continue... The agency agreements essentially say that DWP will continue to do what they're doing at a UK national level. So any overpayments that have occurred in benefits that are currently administered by DWP would you know, it would essentially be end-to-end, so they would flow into those overpayments as well. I think I'm right in saying, James, we're not interjecting and asking a different approach, and the agency agreements, the way they operate, don't really give us that ability to change a part of their process.
That's absolutely correct. I think the agency agreements, the key difference, or the key agreement with DWP, was that it was a business as usual approach. So it is all administered under the UK legislation. So all of the powers that DWP have to recover fraud, error, debt are applied to those benefits under an agency agreement. Again, page 57, it shows the total error on benefits administered under an agency agreement was £7 million in 2020-21. And it will be recovered at a similar rate to the rest of the UK.
I think going forward it would be helpful if we had sort of certain data around number of cases specifically to Social Security Scotland, and especially with the transfer of PIP and things like that, where I think that's maybe going to be more of a live issue. I wanted to ask some questions with regards to staffing and recruitment, and just specifically following our meeting and some useful conversations we had in Dundee, when the workforce strategy was likely to be finalised.
So I think we're working towards a target of next summer, I think I'm right in saying. I think we just, so there are some references to, I think, long-term and short-term workforce strategy, and I think just to clarify, is it the longer-term strategy that you're asking about? Yeah, so I mean, in terms of workforce planning, we've got quite, I believe, a sophisticated workforce planning arrangement within the organisation, where what we're trying to do is to work with the service design that comes in, work with our analysts around about the expected volumes that are likely to appear around about benefits. As you'll understand, if benefits are slightly tweaked in places, that can impact on the volume coming in. So we've invested quite a lot in a team that's able to do some of that workforce planning about the more immediate aspects of it. The longer-term workforce planning, I think, was a point that came through the Audit Scotland report in particular as well. Some of that really hinges on the more longer-term benefits. So I come back to the point in terms of how we work with programme. It's difficult for us to predict what we will need in terms of a longer workforce planning until we're absolutely clear on what service design looks like and how these things plan out as well. So I think that's why that's a slightly longer-term timetable for that. But I would stress that that does not mean there is no workforce planning within the organisation. And I don't think that's what Audit Scotland necessarily is saying in the report. They're just asking for when that starts to look into the longer term.
Thanks for that. And with regards to staffing requirements, why do you think it's increased so much since the programme's business case was put forward, which was published in February 2020? Given that these key policy decisions for in-house assessment, local delivery, and plans around Scottish Child Payment, for example, had already been made at that point. And given the announcements we've seen by the First Minister recently, do you think the organisation is going to grow beyond the 3,500 which is currently envisaged?
So I'll take the first point first. I mean, I would say I haven't, in terms of the programme business casing updated in 2020, the quick answer to that was it simply wasn't updated for the programme business case. So I would go back more to the 2017 projections as to where that figure came from. So all the programme business case was doing was reiterating the 2017 figure rather than a figure which had taken into account some of those changes. So from the 2017 figure onwards, again, I always emphasise that it was an in excess figure. So it was a figure that we were comfortable would be an at least number of people that we needed. But we were also quite clear that lots of decisions had yet to be made which would affect those variables. Some you pointed out, significant, such as in-housing of clinical services. That is something that had not been done at the time as well. Service design for the more complicated disability benefits hadn't come through at the time. There are also, a series of smaller design decisions, if you like, that kind of flow through the system. The duty on the organisation to collect more information to assist with appeals, for example, came through later in the process. So these tend to come through as well. The figure was also based on some earlier assumptions around about how we would operate shared services with the Scottish Government. And I think in reality what has happened, we've probably absorbed more of those functions internally than
elsewhere, including significantly the Chief Digital Office, which transferred to us in April last year, bringing some significant numbers in as well. So for me personally, the programme business case isn't the point I would go back to. It's the outline business case for the organisation, which is where the number came from. I'm sorry, I'm talking, I've forgotten the second part of your question, apologies.
No, it was just specifically around what size you expect the organisation to be from the initial estimates to this 3,500 we now see.
So I think we've always talked about steady state, and as I said in the opening statement, we're a long way from steady state. So it will, as DWP indeed does, it will peak and spike depending what's going on and depending how we launch benefits as well. The final determiner will essentially be the balance between technology and people. And that's where I think, you know, the agile design comes into this as well. So there'll be, if some things are done technologically, then that might push our costs into contracts with IT. If those aren't done and they're done with people, it'll push costs into there. So it's one of the reasons we're slightly reluctant to continually push figures out, because it is an agile development and our staffing requirements are in a way, you know, a consequence of how that agile looks like as well.
That's very helpful. And just finally on staffing from me, what's the organisation's strategy with regards to the skill set? And we again touched on this in our conversations, but the 400 advisors, for example, which you're now looking to recruit for hubs and across the country, what sort of workforce challenge in recruiting them have you already discovered? And I think one of the concerns which was expressed was potential destabilisation of other services if we see individuals coming into Social Security Scotland who are very much working in the front line somewhere else at this moment in time. I think specifically around Dundee, that was maybe something, given that maybe a recruitment pool you've already kind of been drawing on, and that was some of the conversations we had. So I just wondered, in terms of that specialist skill set strategy, what where you are with that, and individuals being identified?
So there's probably two slightly different specific elements in there as well. But local delivery, whilst it's a really skilled and experienced group of people we're bringing in, isn't as highly specialised as I think some of the clinical appointments that you're probably talking about as well. So local delivery has not generally been a problem in terms of recruitment. You're right, we have taken people from a variety of different areas, you know, whether that's third sector, whether in some cases it's other government departments or other services, but at a local delivery level that hasn't been a particular issue. Just on the clinical, we're obviously developing our clinical approach based in part of to how the initial team staffing up child disability payment has progressed as well. So that's probably the area where the highest level of risk, as it were, are we potentially pooling people who may be working in the NHS, for example, at the moment, who may want to come in and work with us. I think it's very early days for us in terms of having any intelligence around about that. Yes, we probably are getting some people from the NHS, but I think actually some early indications are we're possibly extending their working life rather than necessarily drawing them at a different point. And we're also taking people from other areas as well. So our strategy will develop in terms of clinical approach as we go there as well. Mm-hmm. And all the specialist pockets as well will have strategies sort of skewed towards it. Ultimately, I think our strategy, aside from some very specialist things such as clinical, has to be a combination of both recruiting in the market, but also developing our own talent as well. So, for example, on accountancy, on James's side, you know, we have a throughput in terms of trainee accountants. We have good relationships with local colleges around about HR practitioners, for example. So we aren't just going into the market and taking people who are fully qualified and trained. We absolutely see ourselves as part of that pipeline. And Dundee is a good place where we're working both with the local colleges and the universities as well. So we see a responsibility of developing the pipeline, not just of taking people from the market.
Thanks.
Thank you very much indeed. I bring in Jeremy Balfour. Just conscious I have time, I'm going to overrun the session and delay the Minister slightly, but if we could have quick questions and answers, please. Jeremy Balfour, followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Two questions. I mean, just following up that final point, obviously Audit Scotland in their report said this was a particular concern in regard to recruiting people with clinical experience, and obviously with the pandemic that maybe made it worse. Are you looking at different opportunities for working part-time, even working maybe on an agency basis that you might do one day a week but continue being a nurse other time, or OT, other things? Or are you kind of, is it a one model fits all?
Minister, so in the interest of a short answer, yes, I think we'll look at all of those all of those opportunities. Yeah.
Okay, and this is probably a slightly longer question. Obviously, we have the adult disability coming in next year. We've seen the draft regulations. It will be a political decision made by Parliament whether those are passed or whether they are altered. If the Parliament decided that we wanted to transfer everybody across as is, but then we wanted to increase, say, mobility from 20 to 50 metres, and that came in next year, would you have the capacity as an agency to deliver that decision, or would you need more staff in, and at what point do you need that decision made at a parliamentary level? So if what I'm really looking for is, if the regulations aren't just approved but are altered to give more people the opportunity to apply, can you deliver that? And if you can't, when do you need that decision made so that you can bring in more staff?
So I don't have a straightforward answer. We work with our programme colleagues on that. If significant changes were made to the policy at the point of transfer, that would have a major impact on the resources we require. That's probably the short answer to it. I'm happy to take it away and write back if that's of help.
I think it would be really helpful if we could get some kind of indications around those questions inviting for us to have a look at. Yeah. Thank you.
But just to address, it would have a significant impact on the staffing implications.
OK, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
That would be helpful because obviously eligibility at ADP in particular is an area that we're going to be looking to touch on, and it's going to be the chunkier end of the work that's coming through next year, I suppose. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you for that, and thank you for your answer to the previous question. It is really helpful, and I look forward to seeing the
submission
that you make to the... Sorry. That you make back to us, so thanks. Just very briefly, how are you ensuring that the ethos of eligibility will change from the current system of personal independence payment to the new system of adult disability payment? What are you doing with your workforce to make sure that it's a different type of process?
I know we're pushed on time, but could you just maybe just clarify what you mean by in terms of how we will work with people or...
Yeah, mainly how you work with people. So we've heard a lot about, obviously, eligibility and adequacy of payments will come further down the line, and that would be a whole other session, I'm sure. Yeah. But in the meantime, how are you making sure that the process through application or transfer, and in particular around the child disability payment, the adult disability payment, when that happens, is better than what it currently is with the DWP?
In the interest of time, I mean, some of that is, as we've worked up until now, in terms of the benefits we're currently delivering. So how we recruit people, how we induct people. So, you know, similar conversations were had, you know, 3 years ago about if we were to take people in from DWP, how would we make sure that we had a different culture? Some of our answers there remain valid. It's the skills we looked for, it's the experience that we're pulling in, and it's fundamentally the attitude. So how we recruit people into it, how we induct people into the organisation. It probably comes back to the charter point as well as to why I think it's so important that our staff views are represented in that charter as well, because you can't have the system operating without one or the other. So I think we've got some experience and some learning from how we've currently grown the organisation, but it's getting the right people, making sure they're trained, making sure that they're getting that experience as well is probably the shortest answer I could give on it.
That's all for
thank you very part. Much. Miles, did you have a question in the final section?
Thank you, Convener. It was just with regards to spend, with regards to budgets, and probably the most important stuff, budgets, to be honest. But finally, I just wondered in terms of what view you maybe had with regards to the variance we've seen between budgets and actual spend to date.
For the year that this set of annual report and accounts relates to, again, I would come right back to, you know, it was a disrupted year through COVID. So I think a number of the variances in there are directly related to A, some replanning on the programme, so actually some benefit launches shifting. Clearly, when the budget was set, we had a different programme in mind, so as a result, they would knock on as well. That goes likewise for capital. So, you know, as you know, it was great to see you in Agnes Husband House, but there's, you know, it's not quite there yet. You know, in a non-COVID world, we would have expected to have some of that capital expenditure gone and done and completed. So there has been absolutely a knock-on from it. As you know from the budget, the vast majority of it is staffing. So if we're reprogramming when a benefit launches, inevitably that changes when we would try to bring people in, and that change then creates an underspend in it. So I think it's an unusual year. Clearly, you know, how we monitor that will be, you know, continue to go forward. But the as long as there's huge variances in what volume might look like, what benefit launches might look like, I think it's an implication of that.
And do you think that will have an impact on future forecasting then? Off the top of my head, I think you currently are around 10% cost to delivery. I think DWP 6.4%. Do you see that increasing as is currently sort of laid out in to date costs?
Stick by the numbers that we put in our corporate plan, which, as you say, does sort of say that it's not a competition, but that benchmark of what it takes to run a benefit system around about the 6% is where we'd want to head. At the moment, as I mentioned earlier, we're doing benefits which generally require a one-off application and a one-off, you know, look at that application and a one-off appeal. As you get more into the recurring benefits, you're managing a caseload rather than doing all the front-end work. How that bump smooths out in part comes back to the question about transfer of cases. So we're just starting to get some evidence about transferring the child disability payments. So how long that bump goes on effectively is how long we're paying DWP to still do something versus also doing it ourselves. But absolutely, the graph that's in our corporate plan about saying our target is to be down there is still correct.
Thanks. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. How long do you expect to be spending money on the agency agreements? And do you believe that the spend that you're using for agency agreements, if you were delivering those benefits through Social Security Scotland directly, would it be a like-for-like comparison? Or would you be able to deliver it slightly more cheaply in terms of the administrative costs, or would it be more expensive?
In the interest of time, there's probably a very long, complicated answer to that. I mean, one of the ways of looking at that, if you did the straightforward math of how much we're paying DWP, that probably equates to about another 2,500 people, for example. But it's not as straightforward as that. DWP are more mature in terms of their technology and their processes. How long we'll need to pay them as long as they're doing cases for us is the short answer. So the majority, once we've got adult disability embedded and transferred across, that's when the significant chunk of that will come across. We do have arrangements for challenging the agency agreement costs, so it is not a straightforward process of they send us an invoice and we simply pay it. James is part of a group which challenges those costs as how they've been arrived at. And indeed, you know, in reference to the previous question, we do that changes as well. So some of the underspend can come because actually the estimate of agency agreements can vary through the course of the year. Again, if there's a fuller explanation around about how agency agreements operate, I'm happy to commit that in writing.
Be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As we're still within the window of revised timings that I'd suggested to the Minister for the next section, I'll ask one final question, which was, at the session that we had in Dundee, you had suggested about the feeling of the organisation in terms of the speed of scaling up, speed of rollout of benefits. And it'd be useful for that suggestion that was made in that informal session to be put on the record for my benefit, please. That is, do you feel that you are moving at pace in terms of scaling up? Are you comfortable with that pace? Do you think that you could be going faster in terms of rolling out new social security benefits and taking on responsibility for existing?
So I'll try and remember the answer I gave you in Dundee, convener. So from an organisational perspective, this feels fast and furious. The 11 benefits in just over 3 years effectively is almost dropping a new benefit every quarter. And some of the stuff that you see both in our annual report and accounts and Audit Scotland referencing, guidance, for example, some of the points have been how do you continually make sure your staff have got the absolute up-to-date guidance, know about referrals, know about advocacy. Some of these, that is a consequence of that pace we're going at. There is one programme planned, so I'm loath to kind of say, we could go a bit faster or the programme could go a bit faster. There is a joint plan of delivery. But from the agency's perspective, it does feel fast and furious.
And do you feel that you have the support in order to meet that fast and furious timetable of rollout?
Absolutely. I think there is always a balance between paying money to people who are entitled to it versus the organisation saying we're ready to do that. And inevitably, there are always some things we would like to have in the organisation before we do that. But we're fully involved in those decisions, and I absolutely agree that getting forward with the payments is the absolutely most important thing to do. And that might be, back to some of the previous questions, meaning we're doing something slightly more manually than we would ideally like to do. We would like a system to check something here. But actually, I think that's a appropriate compromise for us to make sure we're paying people in Scotland.
And most importantly then, do you feel that you're getting it right for the clients at the pace that you're going at?
I don't want to be complacent on that. I mean, I think, again, back to the client survey, we'd be driven by the client survey. I do think some of those responses are really, really positive. I think that's from surveying a group of clients, that's a phenomenally positive response. So on balance, I think yes. But that is not to be complacent, as members have asked about here, about those that are feeling slightly less positive about it. So, again, it's always that balance. Yes, I think we're broadly there, but we want to make sure that we're still a learning organisation. So how we take the learning from the Charter, how we take the learning from clients and make sure that we've got the space and stability to implement some of those changes whilst benefits continue to come down the track will always be a challenge. But it's what makes these jobs particularly exciting and challenging at the moment.
Thank you very much indeed to you all for coming in and giving us your experiences and putting your experiences over the last few years on the record. I would greatly appreciate your time. And as I said at the outset, looking forward to having a regular and productive relationship with yourselves and look forward to that progressing. So thank you very much indeed on behalf of the committee for your time again this morning. We'll now suspend briefly to allow for the changeover of witnesses. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Indeed, the committee will now take evidence on the Best Start Grants and Scottish Child Payment Miscellaneous Amendments Regulation 2021. I welcome again to the committee Ben McPherson, the Minister for Social Security and Local Government. Online, the Minister is joined by Pauline Torley, the Scottish Child Payment Policy Manager, and Karen Clyde, the Solicitor for the Scottish Government. I'd like to invite the Minister, please, to make an opening statement.
Thank you and good morning, Convener. Good morning, members. These regulations before us will make sure the Scottish Child Payment and Best Start Grant regulations align with our original policy intent of getting payments to the person responsible for the child. Best Start Grant is aimed at giving children the best start in life, offering financial support to eligible families at key points in a child's early years. Scottish Child Payment is also the most ambitious child poverty reduction measure in the UK. It supports families on qualifying benefits who have children under six, extending to under 16 by the end of 2022, all going to plan in terms of getting the data required from the DWP. The Scottish Child Payment is already supporting 106,000 children with payments worth £40 every 4 weeks, increasing to £80 in April next year, as was announced by the First Minister earlier this week. Convener, the First Tier Tribunal highlighted that in a very small number of cases, the Scottish Child Payment regulations for resolving competing cases did not award the person with the child responsibility. Did not award the person with responsibility for the child. A related issue arose with Best Start Grant, where an award was made to someone receiving the child element of universal credit, but someone else was actually caring for the child. Therefore, without these amendments in the regulations before the committee today, we will not always be able to pay the person who is actually responsible for the child. Ordinarily, one person would receive the child responsibility benefit and the use of top-up powers would work to meet the policy intent. But recently it has become clear that this does not always happen in practice, and we are seeking to rectify this. Although the numbers affected are likely to be very low, we are seeking to make the changes in the regulations before us because it is the right thing to do. Draft regulations were referred to the Scottish Commission on Social Security in September, and considering their workload, I was very grateful to receive their scrutiny report in October. We have accepted all recommendations and our response was laid in Parliament on the 12th of November. David Wallace, Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland, also provided an update to SCOS outlining how the agency responded to the problem of competing claims in advance of the regulations being laid, and this clarified how the agency will support the regulations through guidance. The agency will publish updated guidance to coincide with the regulations coming into force, and I remain extremely grateful to the Scottish Commission on Social Security for its scrutiny and recommendations, and also welcome this opportunity to assist the committee in its considerations of the regulations before us, and I look forward to any questions that members may have.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That's very helpful. If any colleagues would wish to come in at this stage, please indicate, as others have already done so. I'd like to start with Marie McNair, followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Chair. My question's on actually in theme two. Thanks very much, Minister. Are you concerned that the approach you're wanting to take will undermine the shared care of children?
We encourage parents, first of all, with shared care, to make the decision as to who makes a claim. The numbers affected by the changes to the rules are likely to be very minimal, as stated in the opening statement there. And we do not anticipate that this change will deter parents from shared care. We shared the draft regulations with our stakeholder group, and no feedback was received in terms of this outcome. So, I do not believe it will disincentivise shared care.
Thanks for that reassurance. Cheers.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, please, followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Thanks for joining us again. My first question is actually because you've raised the issue of the data. Could you give the committee an update on the data coming from the DWP in terms of the wider rollout, if that's possible, either this morning or in writing? So it'd be good to hear about that. And then specifically on the reason in the first place to go on a first-come, first-served basis for these payments. Be keen to know a little bit about that. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I'll take the second question first, if that's okay. In terms of why was first come, first served considered, it wasn't considered an acceptable backstop provision, but just to give the wider context. In the original Scottish Child Payment rules, it states that a second applicant for Scottish Child Payment who is not higher up the hierarchy of entitlement than a previous applicant will have their application rejected. But in the effect of creating a first-come, first-served rule for two applicants with the same qualifying criteria, so in effect it creates a first-come, first-served rule for two applicants with the same qualifying criteria. However, it was not anticipated that two different people could both satisfy the top tier qualifying criteria, so that wasn't anticipated, which is why we needed to amend the regulations and why we've brought these regulations before us today. I mean, I should say that the reason we didn't anticipate the situation, and no one anticipated the situation could happen through the process of the original regulations, was because it should not be possible for more than one individual to be in receipt of the qualifying benefit with the associated child element for the same child. So where universal credit is top of the hierarchy, only one person should get the child element and one person would get child benefit. We expected that any change in circumstances where responsibility for the child moved, that any associated benefits would move with the child, but it's now come clear that this is not, that it's now become clear that this is not always happening, and that's in the DWP reserved system. So we are making the amendments today in response to considerations within the reserve system in terms of the past, in terms of the reserve benefits, which of course create the entitlement to the devolved benefits in question. So that's just to give the context. With regard to your other question, I have had a recent bilateral with Chloe Smith on the issue of the data for the second phase of the rollout of Scottish Child Payment, and both officials from the Scottish Government and the DWP continue to be engaged in conversations around securing that data for the November 2022 timescale that we are working towards, and to make sure that we progress in the fashion required in order to deliver to meet that timescale.
Thank you.
In terms of the data, because obviously that brought about, the data sharing brought about the delay to the initial rollout of the Scottish Child Payment, are you confident that there's not going to be a further delay, that the data coming from the UK Government, the DWP, will come in time this time round?
I can certainly emphasise that from a Scottish Government position, we are making it very clear to the DWP when we require the data and how we require it in order to meet that deadline. I do not want to say anything more at this stage, Convener, as officials are engaged in good faith on this matter, but I will certainly update the committee in due course as appropriate.
That's very helpful. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Welcome to the committee again. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to shared care, because looking at the regulation, it does seem very clunky and does not take into account separated parents, for example, who might take equal share in caring for a child or their children. So I just wondered whether or not ministers have looked at some solutions to that 50-50 split, for example, when in providing that benefit.
Thank Miles Briggs for that important question. So the situation where two parents should be in receipt of a qualifying benefit for the same child should not be possible in terms of the qualifying benefit. So if the situation arises where both parents have an exact 50-50 split of care and both are in receipt of a qualifying benefit, we would trust that the process of applying for the qualifying benefit would provide clarity by awarding the child element to the parent responsible for the child, and where this fails for any reason and triggers a competing claim for Scottish Child Payment, the rules that allow Scottish ministers to consider the circumstances of the child will apply. And so the evidence that will be considered by Scottish ministers in determining awards in these cases will be set out in the published guidance. So the guidance will be important in terms of those questions.
That's helpful. Reading into that, has any work been done with regards to how that potentially can disincentivise people, separated parents specifically, to take a shared care approach?
I think as I set out to Pam Duncan Glancy, we continue to encourage parents with shared care to make the decision as to who makes a claim. And we shared the draft regulations with our stakeholder group and no feedback was received suggesting this outcome.
Was that also, beyond that group, was there any other assessment or review taking place? Because I think this has opened up an area where I think it's maybe important more work takes place to see whether or not these regulations can sometimes be changed to fit the real world we live in. And I just wondered what maybe additional work beyond these regulations the government intend to do on this.
Sure, I'll bring Pauline in a moment on this, if I may, convener. But of course, the Scottish Government considers to evaluate and consider how all our benefits are performing and what revisals we may need to make to regulations to make sure that they consider the different situations of different families and different circumstances. And indeed, the fact that we've brought these regulations before the committee today is evidence of that continued work to improve the benefits we provide. Pauline, I don't know if you want to say any more about in terms of engagement or any other points that Mr. Briggs has raised.
Yes, sure. Thank you. The Scottish Government is committed to learning about how our benefits work in order to learn lessons for the future. We utilise a programme of ongoing evaluation delivered by analysts and researchers in conjunction with external expertise. We're currently conducting an interim evaluation of Scottish Child Payment, which will focus on the impact on the priority groups outlined in the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. We should have access to emerging findings by the end of this year and a final report early in 2022. And as we move on to the regulations for phase two and rolling Scottish Child Payment out to under 16s, we are currently engaging with our stakeholders and third sector to have a look at the current regulations, how they're working. What we intend to do in terms of amendment regulations and taking on board any feedback as to how Scottish Child Payment is working in practice.
Thank you for that. So following that answer and these regulations, would it be fair to say that we're likely to see a future change quite quickly then, potentially being brought to committee?
It's certainly not the position we envisage as things stand. As has been set out in my opening statement and my previous answers, we are making these changes with regard to issues that have arisen as a result of the entitlement to reserve benefits and the effect that that has on our devolved benefits. We are making changes in order to make sure that the person with responsibility for the child receives the devolved benefit, but we will continue to keep these regulations, as we do all our regulations and our benefits, under continuous review to seek to make improvement where appropriate and where possible.
Okay. Thank you very much, Minister. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you and good morning, Minister. Two questions, if that's okay. Just the first one, kind of on a procedural one, and I think we've touched on this previously, in regard to the time that Scots get to respond. And again, they've pointed out in their report that it was a restricted time. We did get it done. Are you looking going forward at giving them a longer period of time to be able to consider their recommendations? So as a committee and as a parliament, we can take that into account.
I think Mr. Balfour raised an important point, and certainly myself and the chair have discussed these issues and the the amount of consideration that SCOS has had to give, to different sets of regulations over the recent period. We're very mindful of that. I've spoken previously at committee about the extra resourcing that we are providing to SCOS in the period ahead. Certainly the ambition is to give SCOS adequate time to evaluate as appropriate and as required. We, of course, have faced a number of developments in recent months that have required evaluation and engagement from SCOS that weren't anticipated. For example, the regulations around those coming to the UK from Afghanistan, which required consideration quickly and that was unexpected previously to that. So is the ambition to give SCOS to try to reduce the demand on SCOS in the period ahead? Yes. Are we very, very grateful to SCOS's engagement and work over the last months? Absolutely. And will we continue to work constructively with SCOS to make sure that they have the resource that they require? Yes, we are.
That's good to hear. The second question you may want to take away, Minister, rather than announce today. It just occurred to me, listening to you, one of the issues we had when we were putting through carers' allowance was there may well be two people caring for a parent or for a child, but it's again the same stage here, it's first come, first gets. Has there been any looking at that in the same light as this, that you may end up with two people who are actually offering the same care, but only one person is getting the benefit because they applied before the other one? Have there been any evidence taken that has been an issue? And is it something that you and your officials have been looking at in any context at all? And I appreciate that's a bit left field, so I'm happy if you'd rather take it away and respond in writing.
If I may, of course, the wider considerations within Mr. Balfour's question, which also relate to the regulations before us today, are around the qualifying benefit, because of course carers allowance, Scottish Government delivers, DWP under agency agreement continues to deliver carers allowance and also the supplement and this year the additional payment. So these are considerations around the qualifying benefit. The points that Mr. Balfour raises of course are pertinent and important with regard to the development of Scottish carers assistance in the period ahead, and we are going to be publishing our consultation on that shortly. So these are absolutely points of consideration, and if I may take that away rather than necessarily, I mean, I'm happy to respond with any further points of information or interest above what I've said just now. But of course, these will be considerations in the period ahead as we look at the development of Scottish carers assistance.
Thank you very much. If there are no further questions, we will move to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the motion. I remind the committee that only... Oh, sorry, Pam Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, convener. Sorry, forgive me. I had hoped to come to ask a question about the use of discretion, if there's time.
Of course.
Thank you. My colleague Pauline McNeill said in the last committee session that there needs to be quite a bit of scrutiny around the shared care and to understand that, and that you need, therefore, comprehensive guidance. SCOS has highlighted that there could be potential human rights issues if the level of discretion is increased. So can you set out why you've left the detail on the types of circumstances to be taken into account to Social Security Scotland, and have you given them any direction about what that guidance would include?
So thanks to Pam Glancy for that. So we will closely monitor the use of discretion in competing claims, as you would expect. There are currently processes and a number of meetings in place between agency and policy officials to discuss cases that are live at the moment. And these existing provisions between the agency and policy officials will continue. The guidance will be published to coincide with the amending regulations coming into force on the 23rd of December. And we can consider that guidance thereafter if that's appropriate or helpful. But absolutely, these points around discretion need to be considered very carefully with regard to the development of that guidance, and we will be actively, officials will be actively involved in engagement with the agency to make sure that guidance is appropriate for the needs required. Pauline, I don't know if you want to comment any more on Pam Duncan Glancy's question.
Yeah, sure. So I would just add to that as well that in terms of putting the discretion in the guidance and the circumstances where ministers should consider who would be entitled to the payment, it allows us to not be prescriptive with the regulations, which means that regulations
Pauline, your sound dipped off there.
Could you quite fit a set of rules, then we would be able to consider that in the guidance and update the guidance accordingly. But just makes it easier for the different circumstances to be considered.
Did you catch enough of that, Pam Duncan Glancy?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Final question from Maureen McNair, please.
Thanks, Convener. Just come back to the guidance. Is there any consultation on the content of the guidance? And did you say that it would be published on the 23rd of December? Just clarifying that.
Yeah, thanks for that. So the guidance will be published to coincide with the amending regulations coming into force on the 23rd of December. And organisations which are being consulted, we intend to consult with the 5 Family Payments Reference Group, which includes third sector, NHS and local government representation, and also includes the Child Poverty Action Group, CPAG.
Thank you very much indeed. We'll move now to the formal debate on the motion. I remind colleagues that only members and the Minister may take part in the formal debate. I invite the Minister to move the motion, S6M02177, that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Best Start Grants and Scottish Child Payment Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2021 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you very much. Do any members wish to speak in the debate on the motion? No, in which case I would put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M02177 in the name of Bennett McPherson be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. The motion is therefore approved. I would like to... thank you very much, and I thank the Minister and the officials for your time this morning. It's greatly appreciated. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. I would invite the committee to agree that the clerks and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decision and arrange to have it published. Are we content?
Okay.
Thank you. I thank you again, Minister, for your time this morning, as well as your colleagues who have joined us online. Thank you to Karen and to Pauline for your time this morning. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. Our next meeting is on the 9th of December. We will be taking evidence on the third sector's recovery. I suspend this meeting and move to private session. Thank you very much.